Let's solve the question number 7. The potential of a galvanic cell of copper and aluminium H. SRP value is given, that is copper is 0.34 volt and that of aluminium is minus 1.66 volt. So let's see. First, SRP of copper, that is copper 2 plus 2 electron. It is forming copper. Okay. And it is plus 0.34 volt. Similarly, for SRP of aluminium, we can have Al3 plus 3 electron forming aluminium and it is minus 1.66 volt. Now, if we have a galvanic cell of copper and aluminium, then aluminium is more reactive. Aluminium is more reactive because it is above in electrochemical series and copper is less reactive. So, we know that more reactive metal form anode. So, it will form anode and it will form cathode. So the galvanic cell will be like that. Aluminium will undergo oxidation to form Al3 plus 3 electron. Okay. So this is just opposite of this SRP. So its value will be just negative of the previous one, that is plus 1.66 volt. And copper will undergo reduction. So this is copper 2 plus 2 electron forming copper. Okay. And that value is how much? Plus 0.34 volt. Okay. If you want to write the net cell reaction, simply we have to cancel out the number of electron in that. So we have to multiply it with 2, the first one with 2, and the second one with 3, and we have to simply add them. Okay, so overall reaction will be 2 aluminium solid plus 3 copper 2 plus aqueous, giving 2 Al3 plus aqueous plus 3 copper solid. So this is the final net reaction, and the E0 cell for this will be simply sum of these two cell, that is 1.66 plus 0.34 equal to around it will be 4.392 volt. So the potential of galvanic cell of copper and aluminium is actually 2 volt. So that is the A, that is the correct answer for this question. Okay, one important point that you need to remember, when we are adding this equation 1 and 2, we are getting this final equation 3. So this is the E0 cell of this reaction, and final E0 cell is sum of these two. But we should remember that we are not actually adding the E0 cell, because E0 cell is non-additive. It is intensive property. So it is non-additive. So actually what we are adding? We are adding the delta G. Suppose this is delta G1 value, it is delta G2, and for this it is delta G3. Then we are writing simply delta G3 equal to delta G1 plus delta G2. That's all. Now what is delta G? We know delta G is minus NF E0 cell. Okay, that is the final E0 cell. Now delta G1 is for this cell, so it is minus N. N is how much? 3 electron, 6 electron is involved, so 6, because after multiplying it will be 6 electron, into F into E0 cell. E0 cell is 1.66 volt. Similarly, delta G2 plus minus minus N, N is 6 again, F, and E0 cell is 0.34 volt. So what we see there, that F, all F are cancelled out. Okay, so in the final also we can say that 6 electron will be involved, because that will be the same as that in the reduction half or, you know, oxidation half. So here N will be also equal to 6. So this will also be cancelled out, and finally we'll have minus E0 cell equal to, this will also be cancelled out, 1.66 minus 0.34, sorry. So overall E0 cell will be equal to 2 volt. Okay. So basically we are not adding the E0 cell directly, because that is an intensive property, that is non-additive. We are basically adding the delta G1 and delta G2 to get the final delta G3. And delta G3 we know is minus N if E0 cell, then we'll get that E0 cell to be 2 volt. And always remember, main is the number of electron involved, N. In this N is 3 into 2, 6. In this also 3 into 2, 6. And for this also, it will be 6 only, because the oxidation and reduction reaction of this equation, basically overall redox reaction, has the 6 and 6 electrons. So here also it will be 6. So that's the final answer, that is 2 volt. Let's move to the next question. Okay, the question is, the peak in the corrosion rate of martensite occurs when? Okay, so that is also a very important question. This is the graph and I have taken it from V. Raghavan, physical metallurgy. This is the corrosion rate and this x-axis is tempering temperature. So we can see at lower temperature, there will be martensite only. At the lower temperature here, we can say it will be martensite only. That will be the only phase. Okay, so there will be no galvanic couple, the corrosion rate will be very less. But as we increase the temperature, you know, cementite precipitates. So at the peak, it will be very high number of, you know, cementite precipitation. And due to the cementite precipitation, there will be a large number of, you know, galvanic cell that will develop. Galvanic cell that will develop. And due to that, it will undergo corrosion or the corrosion rate will be highest. So what is that temperature? Basically, this peak is coming corresponding to this 400 degree centigrade. So at 400 degree centigrade, you know, the corrosion rate is the highest. So the correct answer should be the C. Okay, now. What happens if we increase the temperature further? When we increase the temperature further, the cementite will grow into a bigger size, okay? So they will coarsen or coalescence will form and they will become bigger in size. And due to when they will become bigger in size, what will happen? You know, number of cementite will decrease, or we can say number of galvanic cell decreases and thus corrosion rate decreases. So initially at lower temperature we have martensite only, but when we are doing the tempering, the fine cementite is going to precipitate, and at 400 degree centigrade there will be maximum number of, you know, a small cementite precipitation that will form a huge number of, you know, galvanic cells. So corrosion rate will be very high. But when we increase further the temperature beyond the 400 degree centigrade, okay, then what will happen? This cementite will coarsen, or, you know, coalescence will occur, so it will become bigger in size. And when they will become big, the small will annihilate each other, and, you know, will get a very small number of now galvanic cell left, and that's why the corrosion rate will decrease. So the correct answer is C.
Let's discuss the question number 9. Pore-free coating is required when? So coating should be pore-free. When we require pore-free, so the correct answer is when the coating is noble with respect to protected metal. So in that case, we require pore-free coating. Okay. So let's discuss why it requires pore-free coating. Suppose this is the metal. I'm taking an example of steel. That is the metal. And we have done a coating of, suppose, tin on it. We have done a coating of tin. So this is tin. Okay. Now, if you see the electrochemical series, tin is more passive. It means the steel is more prone to corrosion, but tin is less prone to corrosion. Okay, so tin will act as cathode and steel will act as anode. So in this situation, if any pore is left, suppose this is the small pore, this is the small pore that is left. In that case, what will happen? This exposed area that is very small, tiny, like pit, will be, you know, prone to corrosion. So small pore, this will be prone to corrosion. Why it will be prone to corrosion? Because the metal, that is a steel, is basically more anodic as compared to SN. So anode will get oxidized. It means there will be loss of a steel and it will be corrosion. So always remember, if a metallic coating is noble with respect to, you know, underlying metal like steel and tin, okay, then it we have to avoid all these pores. Even a small flaws or cracks or pores we have to avoid, because these small pores, okay, could initiate corrosion because this small pores will act as anode and will create a galvanic seal there. Okay, so underlying metal will start corroding. And this will be in the form of localized, you know, attack. Only this portion, their corrosion will take place. So maybe, you know, the crack will initiate and it will cause failure of this steel. Okay, so that's the case. That basically exhibits pinhole effect. There will be a small hole formed due to the corrosion. That is the pinhole effect is basically related with that only. So I hope it is clear now. So it's a decoating is made with respect to the protected metal. Okay, coating should be noble with respect to protected metal. Then we require the pore-free coating. Okay. Let's move to the next. So let's see the question number 10. For a cathodic protection at a current density of 10 milliampere per meter square, the quantity of zinc, atomic weight is 16.5.4 amu, required per meter square of sieve hull per year each. Okay, Faraday is given as Faraday constant in 96490. Okay, coulomb per mole. Okay, so basically the current density is 10 milliampere per meter square. So let's solve this. So we know that 10 milliampere is basically 10 by 1000 ampere, and ampere is coulomb per second. So 10 by 1000 coulomb per second. So that is the current density. That is the current density that we are given. Okay. Now, the zinc SRP reaction will be written as Zn2 plus plus 2 electron giving zinc. Okay. It means, or we can simply write, when zinc will undergo corrosion, it will form Zn2 plus plus 2 electron. That is the SOP of zinc, standard oxidation potential reaction. Now, we can see that if we take 1 mole of zinc, and for destruction of 1 mole of zinc completely to Zn2 plus now corrosion, we require how much electricity? 2 Faraday of electricity. 2 Faraday means how much charge is required? 2 into 96490 coulomb. So this much coulomb is required for 1 mole of zinc. And 1 mole of zinc is how much? 1 mole of zinc is 65.4 gram, because atomic mass is 65.4 amu. So 1 mole will be 65.4 gram. So that is basic, you know, mole concept that you should know. Okay. Now, so what we can conclude from that 2 into 96490 coulomb, okay, is required to consume 65.4 gram of zinc. Okay. Or this much coulomb is consuming this much gram of zinc. So what is the current density? 10 ampere milliampere per meter square. It means how much is that? It is 10 by 1000 coulomb per second. So we can say that how much coulomb per year? So 10 by 1000 into 365, because 1 year is 365, you know, days, into 24, it means this much will be hours, into 3600, so it will be total second. So this much coulomb is required. Okay, basically this much coulomb will be passed if we have a current density of 10 milliampere per meter square, you know, flowing throughout a year. So this much coulomb will be passed, this much coulomb, and we know this much coulomb is consuming this much of zinc. So what about this much coulomb? How much it will consume? So let's simplify that. it is basically 365 into 24 into 36. This coulomb is, if you multiply it, it will be 315,360 coulomb. So that is the coulomb of charge that has been passed to that sifal per year. So this is the charge in per year. And this much is consuming this much gram of zinc. So one coulomb will consume 65.4 divided by 2 into 96,490 gram of zinc. And what is given here? 315,360 coulomb will consume. So it will be how much? So it will be 65.4 into 315,360 divided by 2 into 96,490 gram. And if you just simply solve it, we are getting 106.86 gram. That will be in kg, 0.106 kg, or approximately it will be 0.1 kg. So 0.1 kg will be of zinc will be consumed if this much current density will be flowed through the sifal per year. So that's all about the various questions of this V. Raghavan book from the chapter Oxidation and Corrosion. Thank you.